Good morning, friends. Let me congratulate all of you for choosing to join this course. The world is full of a lot of tensions today. If everything going smoothly, all the countries in the world decide to work as friends with each other, probably there may not be need and a role for a diplomat and for diplomacy. Because diplomacy essentially means building relationship with other countries. If we accept that there is a friendship, means the relationship is already there. So where is the need and the role for diplomacy and diplomats? But today's world, where you can see all around, in almost all parts of the world, there is some tension. In some parts, there is a friction. In some part, there is a confrontation. And therefore, in such context, to reduce it, to build good relationship, there is a room and a need for diplomacy. And therefore, I congratulate you because you are joining at such a time, which will ensure that you in future will be able to play a key role in representing the interest that you choose to in, because some of you may not be representing India. But any country that you choose to represent, you will be able to use the skills that you acquire today, the knowledge you gain today in the course of last 3 days and tomorrow, and that will help you in terms of focusing on the issues on hand. And also maybe this could be a beginning of choosing a full-time career as a diplomat. So therefore I wish to congratulate you. Also congratulate my colleagues in India Foundation and of course my colleague in the government, the Minister of External Affairs, for allowing and making this happen. In my opinion, this is a very unique event in which all the different facets of diplomacy are being discussed, different contours of India's foreign policy are being explained, and I'm sure this will go as a very good input for you, and will probably some of you may be motivated to take full-time careers in diplomacy, and I wish that happens. I've been given a topic that is India's economy is a global calling card. If you really look at diplomacy in modern times, there is a diplomacy pre-war time to prevent wars. There is a diplomacy during war times, and if you recall, even during the worst of wars, including world wars, there was always a second channel which was kept between the warring parties. So there is a diplomacy during war times also, and there is a diplomacy post-war time. How to now create a new one? But that's the kind of diplomacy which we need to deal with situations arising out of serious conflicts, maybe for territorial claims or for other reasons, when you fight wars. But during, when there are no war, and still we think about diplomacy, one of the most driving force for that diplomacy would be economic issues. any country will like to promote through international relations their economic interest. Let us think about that in a little broader term. What is a foreign policy anyway? A foreign policy of any country, has to be essentially to promote their domestic agenda. It's an extension of your domestic concerns articulated in terms of international relations in the foreign policy. I don't think any country in the world would say that I have a domestic policy which is at variance with my foreign policy. So if your domestic agenda has to be further promoted and taken forward through international diplomacy, international policy, then show me one country in the world today which says that my domestic agenda is not my economic growth. So if the domestic agenda of any country is economic growth for that country, your foreign policy obviously would be economic. Because as I said, domestic policy is further in terms of economic policy, in foreign policy. So therefore, all the time, except as I said during war times when the demands are different, your foreign policy has a very large component of economic policy, economic consideration. Even today, if you look at it, when Donald Trump talks about, President Trump talks about America first, what does he mean by America first? He says that America must progress first, and he tried to explain that in Davos only a few days ago by saying America first does not mean America alone. Why? Because to also America first, America cannot achieve it alone. That means you have to have an engagement with so many other countries in the world. So that means America will have to pursue a foreign policy to engage with a lot of other countries in the world to promote America first. So in fact, to look at the other way around, I was saying domestic policy gets reflected in foreign policy, but here foreign policy will be designed to create a domestic environment wherein the America first can be achieved. So therefore, economy policies have become one of the most important components now of a foreign policy of country, and particularly for India. We are a growing economy. Unlike many other countries in the world, our economy has not plateaued. There are economies which have grown, even like US, which is the largest economy, which at best can grow at 2%, 3%, 4%, which itself is great, because when you have such a large base, you will grow at 4% is not small, because the output, what is GDP, is economic output. The 4% output on a large economy will be much higher than even double that rate in a smaller economy. But still, it is like a plateauing of economy, European Union. Even China, as you have seen, after having a double-digit growth for a very long time, from after 1978, particularly after Tiananmen Square and 86-87, after almost 10 years of initial reforms, Chinese economy was growing constantly at 10% plus. But now it has slowed down, come down, and it will slowly plateau down. Unlike that, India's economy is on the rise. It is going to be constantly growing for at least few decades more. Certainly. And for such an economy which is growing and has a potential and a capacity to grow and a need to grow. It has a potential and capacity but also need, because despite being third largest economy in the world today, on the way to become the world today. And despite the fact that we are $2.5 trillion economy already, still we have a lot of challenges in India. We have a lot of number of poor people in India. Our living standard has to improve considerably. Our infrastructure needs are even much higher today. We need social sector development in a big way. So that means our economy has to rise faster to make all this happen. So there is a need. But just need is not enough. There may be need. But whether there is a potential, yes, India's potential to grow is huge. And therefore, if you want to have a potential to grow, there is a need to grow. Then what policy we should have in the economy? We can have, like some countries did for so many years, that they put iron curtain and they said, no, we'll just grow on our own. But we have seen the pitfalls of that. You cannot grow in modern times at a faster rate unless we are integrated into global economy. And that's why Prime Minister made a very interesting statement in Davos only a few days ago, that we are for globalization and we want to engage with the rest of the world to promote economic growth. Now what does it mean? If Prime Minister is making this statement that we want to engage with the rest of the world for economic development, that's our calling card. We are telling the world, please come and invest, and that's a part of foreign policy. Because how do you engage with the rest of the world? Diplomacy means engaging with other countries in the world. And therefore, now India's main thrust would be promoting diplomacy primarily, along with other reasons, is to develop economic relationship to bring in faster economic growth in India. India is now one of the fastest large economy of the world. But as I said, and this is not a political statement, one day I will convince you by numbers that we will definitely grow at least 2 or 3% point more than what we are growing today, at least for next few years, and then probably in the next few years' time we will also cross that mental barrier, the physical barrier of 10% plus. And then we can really grow for that, at least, I hope, for at least 2 decades more. And that would be a real game changer, because then we'll be growing at a rate at which our growth rate will be more than the aspiration rate of the people. And therefore we'll be able to match not only aspiration, but we'll be able to create infrastructure also at a rate faster than that. But to make that, we need many things. We have to put in place domestic policies, I will not go into that. But internationally and globally, unless we get foreign investment into India to supplement our domestic savings, which are luckily rising now very well, we will not be able to get the desired results. Because economic growth is a function of investment as well. There is the other side which makes economic growth possible, that is the consumption. But investment is one of the driving force for economic growth. The economic output, which is GDP, cannot be achieved without input. And one of the major inputs for getting that economic output is investment. And even if our domestic savings rise, to get that dream rate, which I said should be 8%, 9% plus, we need more investment. And therefore we need engagement with the rest of the world. That means our economic diplomacy has to be attuned to that possibility. Secondly, to grow, we must be able to sell more outside. All the countries in the world which have registered phenomenal growth rate, whether it is China, whether it is Japan, whether it is Korea, they have all been able to do it because they were able to integrate themselves with global trade in a big way. China is the largest exporter today, largest importer today. And because they are the largest exporter, largest importer, I would say they are also largest manufacturer. It is not that because they are largest manufacturer, they became largest exporter. Because the export market had to be created. Therefore, the back-ended part was largest manufacturing. Now, the other economic aspect, which I said one is investment, other part is getting access to global markets. If you do not get access to global markets, how will be able to sell more and produce more? And unless you are able to produce more, how are you going to have more GDP rate? And unless you have better GDP rate, how are you going to reduce poverty? How are you going to bring affluence to people of India? And that all would mean that we need a proper strategy to make more exports. We in India, and I am as a Minister of Commerce and Industry, are right now preparing a policy that in the next 7 to 8 years' time, we'll be $5 trillion economy. That is inevitable. That's only at today's rate of growth. In that, 40% of that should come from global trade. That means $2 trillion, which would include, of course, imports and exports. And without import, you cannot export. And that's, let me tell you later. But to have that $1 trillion of exports, you need a strategy, economic diplomacy. Our foreign policy must be ready to make that happen. We must engage with countries where we can export more. We must get market access. We must develop relationship at political level so that we can actually sell them even economically. That's the role of foreign policy. And therefore, to make that happen, we are preparing policy and we are actually preparing a roadmap of what markets, what's the marketing strategy there, and what product we can sell. But that's another part of our foreign trade policy. But in today's context, what we are discussing, foreign policy, therefore, will have to make sure that my strategic interest of having exports more into the other markets, how do I create a foreign policy which will make it happen? How do I develop relationship? So right now what we are doing as a commerce minister, this is a broader policy framework which we have to prepare, as I said, which is being prepared in consultation with foreign ministry. Yesterday we had a long chat with a new foreign secretary, almost 1.5 hours. We are working very closely with each other. He had come to my office, we had a long chat with him. Before that, of course, with my good friend Jaishankar, who retired as foreign secretary, with him as well. But yesterday we had a very focused discussion on which market, what to do. But in that, to promote export, there will be two elements. One, bilateral relationships. In that, again, I'll put into two parts. There are some countries where India has invested a lot politically. Political capital, even financial resources have been invested in those countries. It normally presumed that when you have such a good economic political relationship, economic relationship is good. But I calculated there are certain countries which have fantastic political relationship, but hardly an economic relationship. I'll give only one example. And there are many I can give, but I'll just give one example. Cuba. A country with whom we have a long relationship. And we have been friends and colleagues in NAM, we have been opposing American embargo openly, despite the fact that we have such good relationship with US. But with Cuba, we don't have good economic relationship. So I was in Havana recently. I met all the top leadership and I explained this to them. They said, we are more than happy to do with you because you are a friend rather than doing with anybody else. So I got not only earned goodwill, but earned something else, which reminds me every time I visit to Cuba, because when I was coming out of the president's house, I slipped and I have one of my muscle tears, so I keep remembering that I have been to Cuba. But, so there are two areas. One, where we already got good political relationship, convert them into economic relationship. Where we see a potential of economic relationship, but we don't have good political relationship, our foreign policy role should be, How do I create better political relationship with them so that my economic relationship can be developed? And that's the calling card that we have. The second element is multilateral platforms. We can use, you must use multilateral platforms to develop economic relationships so that we get more access to market, we can export more. And there we have to rethink our entire multilateral strategies, whether in WTO or any other forum. India, as I said, has a large number of poor, one of the largest in the world. So we always will articulate the concern of poor people in the world in WTO. But we are still one of the largest economy in the world. So we are also to be taken into account that reality. Therefore, we should also focus and position ourselves into multilateral negotiation to ensure that WTO remains relevant to modern times, which benefits us because that gives us access to markets. And therefore, we are arranging a multilateral mini ministerial in India in March in Delhi. We are calling some top countries in the world so that we can discuss the issues so that WTO remains relevant. So one, as I said, the foreign policy for promoting trade, one is where political relationships are good, but economic relationships are not good, how to do that? And second, in that bucket, how to make political relationships with such countries where there is a potential for economic relationship is high. And as I said, second bucket will be multilateral, where we should use this platform. And a third will be the bilateral contract that we must have, whether it's foreign trade agreements or something. You must identify the countries where we need to engage with them and develop a long-term relationship with them so that we get access to their market. And I must tell you something. This is something which is very important to understand. We feel that we must have a treaty with country in the world wherein we only benefit. It's a fantastic idea. I need to find out amongst you or somewhere else, anywhere in the world, a diplomat who can negotiate such a treaty. That only I will benefit, but you will not benefit. But still you must sign an agreement with me. You must say that I will sign a treaty with you so that I can export to you, but I will not import from you. I wish if any one of you or your other colleagues somewhere else or your friends anywhere in the world, you please identify such people for me. So that we can sign such treaties where we can only export and no import obligation. Fantastic idea. But just imagine, this idea is so good because some of my friends in India proposed this idea. Fantastic idea. But unfortunately, the problem with the idea is that like any other idea, this should be known to others. So other countries will say that this is a very good idea, we'll follow India's example. That we'll only export but not import. And all countries in the world decide, it's a fantastic idea, so many countries are doing, we'll also do it. So all countries in the world decide that we'll export but not import. Now tell me, who can export without an import? So that means we are agreeing, all of us unanimously, there's a brilliant idea, is brilliant, therefore everybody has implemented, now no export, no import, no trade at all. So, in diplomacy, you must always remember that to gain something, you have to give in something. And the economic diplomacy should be such that don't give up everything, it should not be a surrender, but try to develop through diplomacy, means economic diplomacy, a win-win formula. Wherein you give something, wherein you don't have a stake. Gain something from that market where you have large possibilities of gaining out. India, as you know, is a large service economy. Two-thirds of our GDP comes from services. And as I told you, I am preparing this plan. In this 5-trillion economy, 1 trillion, I told you 40% will be the global trade. Services will play a very key role in exports. Services export will rise at a rate faster than merchandise exports. Now, when you make a treaty like this, you must find out how we can get access to services. And the advantage of services is manifold. One, I am now making a statement with a baggage because I was also environment minister, I was water reserve. But if you export merchandise, you are actually exporting some material. And globally, materials are in shortage. Going to be bigger challenge in the world tomorrow is the materials. But when you export services, you are not exporting anything. When you are exporting agriculture, you are actually exporting a virtual water. Countries in Latin America can afford to do it because they are 26% of the water of the world. India, with only 4% of the global water, needs to think very intelligent. And I am promoting global agriculture export anyway, but of a different kind. So services don't come with any input like that. Services provide more jobs and create more jobs than manufacturing, and will create more jobs in future manufacturing after 4th industrial revolution. Because 4th industrial revolution would mean that fewer jobs for the same unit of production that you are producing earlier. So when you are actually exporting a service, you are creating more jobs downstream within your own country. So what should be your strategy for bilateral deals or even multilateral deals, or even when you go and have access? Try to promote more service exports from India. Whether it's in, you already have IT, which is $112 billion of exports. But there are so many services which are not even being thought of. We agree that we are going to grow because we say we have a demographic dividend, because our population is young. But there are a lot of countries who have a lot of aging population. Now, who is going to take care of aging population? As conventionally everybody has seen that older the person, younger person has to take care of it. That's why we even decided social norms that respect the elderly. Must have been thought about by elderly people only, properly. Knowing that if we don't develop such a norm, then who is going to take care of me? So the elderly people said that young people must respect elderly people. So old person like me, I devised a norm that person like my good friend Sopan must respect me, he is younger than me. Only because of age, otherwise he is senior in all respect. But if elderly are to be taken by younger people, can we not convert into an economic activity? Home care can be a very good service industry in the future. There are people in affluent countries are only waiting to hear a human voice. Robots cannot do that. Maybe advanced robotics may be doing that, but still it is a robotics. So there are services which can be done. So our strategy should be to promote services export and services as one of the principal ideas. Coming to the issues of overall, as I said, our diplomacy, economic diplomacy, should be to get investments into the country, which I said will promote domestic growth. We must also have technology which comes through that. So that is why we should try to get investment which embedded with technology. We must also have economic diplomacy to promote India's export promotion, which includes services as well as merchandise, as well as agriculture, of course. But also, we must think about and realize one important thing, that how economic diplomacy helps you geopolitical issues as well. Export, create an economic footprint in that country. Because see, as I said, exporter means somebody is importing. He becomes a stakeholder. He's a counterparty. So you are creating a huge pool of people who are now involved with you in your economic activity. So that creates a critical mass for people to help you tap into for geopolitical reasons. So that is one of the key components of export would be also to promote geopolitical interest. In fact, I'll tell you from my personal experience of last few months that I've been a commerce and industry minister, that countries are more than interested to talk only about commerce and industry or economic activity than anything else. I was in Abu Dhabi for a high-level task force meeting, which is chaired from the Abu Dhabi side by the Crown Prince's brother. They have probably, because they don't disclose it officially, three major sovereign wealth funds. One is the biggest is IDA, Abu Dhabi Investment Authority, which he also chairs. Then there is Mubadala, then there is Abu Dhabi Investment Company, 3-4. It is rumored that all day of them may be about more than $2 trillion, which is India's GDP is 2.5. So you can imagine there is an investable surplus with a small population like that. He is interested to talk to India, and then when I explained to him this vision, he said, first time I'm hearing this, we like to align our investment strategy with your vision, because such a large sovereign wealth fund, we cannot invest only, look at only projects, but we want to understand the vision so that we can align 20, 25 years of an investment strategy, which normally we do. But a country like that, the spin-off will be geopolitical benefit. So anywhere go in the world, I see so many prime ministers, president, want to talk about commerce and industry. And so is our prime minister doing, because he wants to promote India's economic growth. So that means now in future, diplomacy will have to be influenced and greatly driven by economic considerations. So therefore, what we are discussing today is a global calling card, is absolutely the most appropriate thing to do. The second element of it is, as I said, the investment, everything else. Why India? That's very important. Why would there so many countries can do the same thing? And that's why I just casually mentioned earlier that India is a growing economy. When we say we'll be $5 trillion in the next 7-8 years, do you understand what it means? We'll be creating another India. 2.5 trillion of today's India's economy is accumulated of so many years of activity. When we become 5 trillion, that means we are going to create another India in another 8 years. And that is the potential of India. So today who are talking to us are talking to us because of this size. But when they get engaged with us, they become part of this size. Because they get engaged, we'll also grow faster, and this size can become this size. But that could not happen with all countries because they must have the potential. And therefore, our calling card should be our domestic economy, primary. We must understand that whatever we get is to further our domestic interest. And not at their expense, of course. Nobody is saying that we benefit and you lose. We want to develop a model wherein you invest, we also benefit, you also benefit, you get dividend, you get returns, and you'll be happy. If investor is not happy, investee can never be happy. And therefore, we have to develop that model, and therefore, FDI policy of India is designed in that manner, that we have removed virtually all the caps on investment, removed a lot of roadblocks, and we are making it happen. I can see, if you play our cards properly, we'll be the biggest beneficiary of today's difficult world, which I said earlier. Because let us take geographies. US is obviously the largest market. But again, I said they can grow at a particular rate. And that too now, there's a growing protectionism would mean that engagement of US with the rest of the world, even by saying that we don't want to grow alone. But the policies are designed in such a way that will not make it very easy for them. EU, the only driver of that big driver of that EU bloc is Germany. And post-UK Brexit, again, one of the large economies, because after Germany, UK and France are the largest, so after UK's exit, there is going to be another issue there. But they are also facing the Intel problem, so that's another block. Japan which is the third largest economy today, has already some problems. It is not growing at all, despite Abenomics, despite the big thrust that they are trying to put into that. And we are friends with all. In fact, we have a huge trade surplus with US. The only country where we have used trade surplus. With EU is one of our largest trading partners. Japan is one of our most preferred economic partners. So we have all good relations with them and we wish them well. But I am saying the reality of the world. Our good friend and neighbor China has already slowed down the growth rate. They are still a large economy, almost $12 trillion today. Very large, almost 4.5 times of India. But still, tomorrow's growth may not be as high as it has been yesterday's growth. So where is the possibility? India is a place where we can benefit from this global situation it has emerged today. So our diplomacy should be designed in such a way how to benefit from this already created geopolitical situation in which economic possibilities in India are enormous. Investments can be rewarding to people who make investment with us. The domestic market is growing. We should grow faster. And with some of the domestic structural reforms which the Prime Minister has made, whether it is GST or whether it is demonetization, which has formalized the economy in a big way, all of this is going to pay us huge dividends in future. In fact, today's slight slowdown is the initial pain of that reform. And if somebody believes that we can have reform without pain, then either he is kidding or he is writing a fiction. So therefore, we must realize that pain is already over and gain is going to begin. And this is the phase at which we are starting today. That India's economy, mark my words, if you were going to organize next year, Alok, if you organize an event every year, yes. If I am here next year again, I will tell you this and you can make me accountable for that. India's economy in 2018 will be growing at a much faster rate than 17 and 19, not because of election, but because of the intrinsic strength of India's economy will grow even at faster rate. So that's the potential of India. For geopolitical reasons, because of intrinsic reasons, because of structural changes that have been made in India, because of type of situation we are in, type of global positioning we are doing it, we can really hugely benefit from it. So if everything is aligned like this, that your horoscope, everything is coming in the right place, Rahu Ketu had decided to take a little bit of a vacation. In that situation, why not create a diplomatic strategy to get best out of this? And we have a calling card. It may be prepaid or postpaid, I don't know. But we have a card which can be used effectively through diplomatic means, and that can really create a huge economic potential for us. And as I said, India has always believed in not to promise more and deliver less, but we should therefore less promise and deliver more through our economic diplomacy. Tell people to come and try themselves, which I keep telling people. When people ask me, when in Davos, I met about more than 100 people, CEOs and others. They're asking me, but there are problems. I said, you're absolutely right. If there are no problems, why would there be an opportunity for investment? Investment comes into place where the market is still not perfect, not saturated, not matured, saturated, not matured. So therefore, there is an opportunity. So we may have some difficulties which are constantly overcome. And a good example is increasing India's ranking of doing business, which is more than 100 now. Or 100, we'll try to improve it more. So we are in a very good position today. Let us capitalize on it. Let us use international relations as a means of growing India's economy. China did that. China couldn't have been the second largest economy today, but for foreign investment that went into China. China couldn't have upgraded their infrastructure without getting the best technologies from the world. China couldn't have been in this position today if they didn't have an access to their products in global markets. China is the last, one of the latest Only 15, 16 years ago, China joined the WTO. And the biggest beneficiary of WTO is China. Today, you will hear voices against WTO in many parts of the world, but China is the one country which says WTO is a very good idea. Why? Because they realize the importance of engaging with global community to bring in faster economic growth in India, in their own country. So, this is what we should try to do, not because somebody else had done it, but as I explained to you earlier, that for a strategy well thought of for various reasons which I gave you, it's the best chance for India. This is our global calling card, our domestic economy is our calling card, our leadership. See, a Prime Minister is one of the most respected and most sought after global leaders in the world today. When we went to Davos, there were at least 60 odd heads of government or heads of state who had come there. But who got the honor of addressing the opening plenary? The Prime Minister of India. And he was the most sought after leader. Everybody was present, the hall was full to capacity. Of course, in Davos you can watch from different location as well, but despite that, the hall was completely full. And he was sought after. So leadership of a political leadership like Narendra Modi, who has been, I would personally feel that, one of the best Prime Minister in terms of furthering India's interest globally. Whether it's cultural democracy, the diplomacy, whether India's lifestyle to be marketed globally through either yoga or other, something what he has done is phenomenal. And that is what is our calling card also, that it is something which attracts people to India. I think we should try to capitalize on it and try to make it the best out of it. So let me once again congratulate you for being the participants in this very interesting program. When I was young like you, I never got an opportunity to be in a workshop like this. So I could benefit from such a fantastic program that Alok and his colleagues have organized. But I'm sure you've been young and at the right time in India, you're benefiting from it. So I wish you all the best. Congratulations to you as well as my friends in India Foundation as well as EMEA for doing this. I'm looking forward to working with you. Thank you very much.